Welcome to Florida Focus, a college football podcast. We have a Seminole and a Gator together, trying to put aside their differences and bring you the fantastic world of college football. Thank you for joining us on this ride of hype, hope, and hilarity. My name is Brandon, and I am joined by Chris. How are you feeling about today's show, my good friend?
I am very excited about today's show because it mixes two things that I absolutely love. That is college football and movies. Definitely two of my favorites. So I was excited when we decided to do this topic. But I'm going to be honest, when I was doing a research on it and trying to put the list together, it was a lot more difficult than I thought it would be.
Okay.
Mainly because there just aren't as many movies focusing on college football as I thought there were. There's a lot of football movies, but just college football movies, there's like 10 maybe, and that's, we're talking about theatrically released,
correct,
by the way. And there was a lot more like TV movies and documentaries that I was thinking about, but if it's just theatrically released college football movies, there's not as many to choose from as I thought. But I do like my list though.
Okay. Yeah, I think I agree. And you see football, but there was even some that you have to stretch a little bit to kind of get on a college football list.
Right.
And so I wonder if that comes up. Chris and I want to dive into the world of college football movies in a little bit. And so that's going to be our Fave Five list for today. So, yeah, I agree with your statement. For anybody out there that wants to make some college football movies that would be meaningful, we would really respect that and welcome it for sure.
Yeah. Yep.
All right. So, Chris, before we dive into our Fave Five college football movies, I wanted to throw a question out at you, if that's all right.
That is all right.
Good. So, we have a month of March upon us. We've talked about how our colleges right now are focused on basketball. So, since our passion is college football, I wonder, from your perspective, how, for you as a Florida Gator fan, and I'll answer this for Florida State the best I can as well, how as a Gator fan do you connect the football program and the basketball program? And I'll clarify that a little bit for you.
Please do, because I'm confused.
Okay. So, I see schools like Duke that use their football program to recruit for basketball. Other smaller schools kind of do that. They offer scholarships to one sport to really get you there for another. Most schools are going to do that to get football people into the school via basketball scholarship or some other means like that. What about the basketball program do you see connecting to football? Now, I know that probably the Gators don't have any kind of cross recruits or athletes like that, but when you see new coaches come on the scene and maybe give their opening speech for football, for instance, do you see that as appropriate, or what do you say to the fan that follows basketball more than football? I'm kind of giving you a lot to go on here. I realize that, but what in your mind, what connections do you see from those two sports?
I know that for the longest time, all sports, including basketball, were not even thought of. You know, especially through the 90s, it was just football. Okay. And then obviously, Billy Donovan made basketball relevant, and you could argue that it was or not just a football school or a football and basketball school. But really, recently, we've been winning in tennis to track and field, baseball, the most recent. We've gymnastics. So you could say we're an all sports school, but really, like, it's football. It's going to be football. That's going to be lead the charge. But what I've noticed as far as basketball is concerned is that the university is actually putting a lot of money into the basketball program.
Okay.
I think it was last year, the O-Dome where we play basketball just got a facelift, a big jumbotron in the middle. Just the halls are got a bunch of photos and just plaques, just talking about the history of the O-Dome. Also, in the O-Dome is where you do the swim meets and gymnastics too. So they mean that helps it get a facelift, but really, like, they're putting a lot of money into the basketball program. It'll be never as much as football, obviously,
Right.
but they're making it, you know, making it a priority, a high priority at least, in comparison to some schools where it's just you're a basketball school, you're only focusing on basketball, or you're only focusing on football. But I think Florida's really trying to balance things out, starting with basketball.
Okay. That's a great response. From the Florida State perspective, the Tallahassee Leon County Civic Center, or as it formerly was known, was right next to Florida State's campus, but near downtown as well. And several years ago, couldn't tell you the exact year, the city and county decided they couldn't afford the facility anymore. So Florida State said, we'll buy it from you. So the men were already playing basketball, but the building became completely FSU. So all the banners, all of the graduation ceremonies, even the women's basketball team moved to that facility. Kind of embarrassing that for a long time the women's basketball team actually played on the volleyball court in a much smaller facility, but it just wasn't a big of a draw. And so yeah, it's obviously with Florida State the focus is football as well, but it's kind of coming from a different perspective. We kind of know our role, and that is just to play spoiler to Duke and UNC once in a while. But every once in a while, I would say every 5 years-ish, we have a team that we're like, okay, they could win a few games in the tournament. What I never liked, though, were the people that fall back to basketball when football is not doing well. And, you know, it's in the down years, it's like, oh, well, we did great in basketball. We made the tournament and went to the Sweet 16. So I didn't know if you had gotten a sense of the Gators ever doing that, like, even now, didn't Gators make the Elite Eight in 2017? Does that sound right?
Last year we did, yeah.
Okay. I don't know if you'd heard any rumblings of people, even when the football season wasn't going so well, kind of falling back to that and saying, well, at least we have that.
Yeah, you do. Well, I mean, you have fans saying that, you have fans now saying, at least we have baseball. There's a lot to actually fall back on. But I mean, it makes you feel good because volleyball went to the national championship, you know, final game. Like, a lot of sports are representing, but don't kid yourself. It's football. Like, that's, I mean, I guess basketball has really helped bridge the gap a lot better
Okay.
between the end of the football season and the beginning. It has helped a lot. And but I mean, football is definitely going to
Yeah.
take precedence over everything. But, you know, winning any other sports really, really helps just take your mind off the fact that there is no college football. And we've seen that. And Florida was like that with basketball before Billy Donovan. Lon Kruger was the guy before him. In 94, they went to a Final Four, but nothing really prior to that. Yeah, it's you're trying to the university is really trying to make it balanced as far as importance on all the sports, and there a lot of them are winning, but I mean, don't kid yourself. It's going to be about football.
Absolutely. And the money that football brings in funds the other sports. That's kind of how it's divvied up. Also, as a side note, most people probably know that Florida State baseball has always been good. And I always say we're the Chicago Cubs of the College World Series. That doesn't quite apply now since the Cubs have won a World Series.
Right, so yeah.
But we would always get so close. At least 3 times we've been within 2 games of winning it all and have never been able to do it. Even with our best players. And we have one of the winningest baseball coaches in college football history. College baseball history, excuse me.
Right.
And Mike
Well,
Martin.
both sports.
But, well, yeah. Yeah, it's kind of
How
nice to be able to
many
say that.
I guess what's the capacity for the whether the What's it called for the,
For basketball, the Tucker
yeah,
Center?
for basketball, Tucker Center, yeah.
The Tuck, for short.
Oh, the Tucker.
I I couldn't go a firm number. I'm going to say, 2,500, 3,000, something like that. It rarely sells out unless we have Duke, UNC at home.
Right.
At least when I went to games. I would say that's probably changed now because the ACC has expanded so much. We have Louisville, Syracuse, Notre Dame. Those games would probably sell out too.
Okay.
Quite a slate.
They've done a real good job of upsetting, especially Duke,
right,
in the last few years. Seems like it's crazy. I think that the O-Dome did seat 12,000, but after the renovations, it's like 10,000, 11,000.
Wow.
But still, that's kind of small compared to like Kentucky or Kansas. I mean, actually, Kansas is kind of small, but that's one of the smaller arenas even in the SEC. It's one of the smaller arenas.
No kidding. How about that? The NARS, I may be underselling the attendance capacity, but it's still way less than that.
Right. Okay. Gotcha.
So, yeah, and the reason I kind of picture this in my mind as something to talk about real briefly is the biggest connection to the football team that I've seen is that usually when a new coach is hired, the first event you have the most attendance at and the most people at your school going to would be a men's basketball game.
Right.
And so I've seen the memory that sticks out to me is when Jim Tressel was hired at Ohio State. He came from Youngstown State after winning many Division II national championships. He comes into the basketball game. He makes a welcome speech. And what I'll never forget is he actually said, okay, yada, yada, yada. And we have 316 more days until we play Michigan.
Ah, okay.
So that was kind of how he introduced himself to the school and started to make his mark. But I've seen that happen with others. Taggart did it at Florida State this year because he was hired in middle of December. You're not going to have another home football game. This is where you're going to have the most attendance and the best audience. So that's what I've kind of seen. And I'm sure the Gators do this too, where you'll honor other programs, especially football, at a basketball game.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe at halftime, or you'll see them sitting in the stands, whatever.
Well, in reverse, too, at the football games, you'll see them honoring other sports, too, a lot. The coaches take the basketball games as, an impromptu pep rally. And, hey, while I have your attention, I want you to remind you of the football season.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, that happens. We do it all the time. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I feel like that answers my question. I've seen some crossover, and I've thought about that just recently, so thanks for shedding some light from the Gator perspective.
Actually, I was thinking that the last time this happened is right soon after Mullen got hired, and he addressed the crowd at a basketball game, and then he brought one of the defensive players onto the court, and you know how they have the t-shirt cannons?
Yes.
Well, they had this huge T-shirt Gatling gun cannon. Okay. I don't know if you can imagine it. Google it if you get a chance to. It's this huge round circle with, I don't know, 20 spots for t-shirts, and you just fight rapid fire into the crowd. And they had a defensive lineman just shooting it. It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. I'll have to show it to you one day, but it's just I don't know how to describe it other than this huge Gatling gun that just launches t-shirts out into the crowd.
I've seen the single shooter. I've seen maybe one that has three or four. I have not seen one that big though.
This is one of those it's straight out of American Gladiators, man. You need to two hands. You need to get a good base and just as he's just it's like a Rambo into the crowd.
Wow.
It's crazy. And it was a football player and the football coach at a basketball game doing this. So
I'm sure that was no fun at all to operate, man.
Yeah, I know. I don't know how scary that would be.
Yeah.
Cause this is the first time I've ever seen it. So if you're that football player, I mean, you're a strong dude and all, but that's still kind of intimidating.
Yeah.
I'm launching stuff into fans. I hope this works, because this could go south real quick.
I hope you spread out the wealth. I hate to see people fighting over those things. It's a, you know. But I'm sure you were able to get some enough power to shoot it up to the very top deck.
It looked like it was.
Wow.
It looked like it.
Well, there you go. Well, the next time I go to a basketball game, be sure to look out for the t-shirt.
Yeah.
Cannon.
I don't know what. It was crazy.
Yeah. Well, excellent. So, yeah, that's a good recap. That's also a good memory to have. That's kind of cool. So, yeah. Anything else about the basketball-football connection?
No, I mean, it's just interesting to see, especially at Florida, the dynamic has shifted from solely football to, hey, we're also a basketball school. I'm like, that's nice and all, but no, we're a football school.
Right. And is even as powerful as the ACC has become in basketball, still has never really phased the football program at all for us. It's like, oh, great. So we're grabbing schools like Louisville, Syracuse. So I guess we want to be a basketball powerhouse, which is what they accomplished. But doesn't matter if the conference in football isn't as powerful or isn't competing nationally, we couldn't care less, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's not like we walk around claiming, oh, the ACC's won this many basketball championships. I couldn't even tell you. I just know we've not won any. And, yeah, you know, UNC, Duke, they sneak some in. I think Louisville won a few years ago. And yeah.
Yeah, real quick before we get onto the list, who do you think is the best conference in basketball? Because I think it's the ACC.
It has to be. You know, with all the schools that were added in the last few years, you've got teams that are constantly in the Final Four. And North Carolina is always a powerhouse. The ACC has its share of bad teams, too, so you could argue that the bottom half drags it down. Wake Forest, Boston College, Georgia Tech. Florida State, though, is a solid middle. Like, right. Every year about 500 in conference, and they do beat the big boys every once in a while. We made the tournament this year, which is true every 3 to 5 seasons. We'll make it a couple of times. But, yeah, I don't know top to bottom if there's any other conference that can match up. You take the Big Ten, and you have your Michigan States. You have your Purdue's. That kind of swell every once in a while. Michigan has a good season too, but it never seems to me like it's very consistent.
Right.
Outside of the top two squads in other conferences. The SEC though, I mean, of course you have Kentucky, you have Florida. You have the other seasons that come out of seemingly nowhere, like LSU and South Carolina.
Right.
But you just see the most consistent success in the ACC.
Right, yeah, I think so. From as long as I can remember growing up, it's always been about the ACC. Before they added the new schools, it's always been the ACC as the top.
Yeah, yeah, I completely agree with that. Even before you added, like, all the new schools, the revamping about 2013 or so, you probably could still say number one. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Cool.
All right. Good talk there. Well, the fans want to hear about our top five college football movies, Chris. We better give them what they want.
Sure. Why not?
We teased it earlier, and just a reminder to everybody, Chris and I have separate lists. We don't discuss them in advance. I think it's a good time to remind everybody of our ice the kicker terminology. So I'll kind of break that down for everybody, Chris. If I forget something on this rule, let me know.
Okay.
But since Chris and I haven't discussed these lists previously, there may be times when we have an item on our list that will be the same. So in an effort to not duplicate and to not repeat ourselves, if one person is about to talk about an item on their list, the other person will take an ice kicker, which is kind of like back to the sport, you take a timeout to rattle the brain of a kicker who's going to make a clutch kick that's going to make a difference in the game. So
we just want to make each other think about it a little bit more.
Yeah, and then when it comes a more appropriate time, then we'll discuss it.
Right.
So let's hope I get this right this time. I don't step on your toes.
I feel like there's going to be a lot in this one. I feel like we're going to get confused, but hey, it's going to be fun regardless.
I love it. So I'll start with my five, and I'll throw it to you, Chris, after you're done. I'll start with four, then back to you, and then so forth until we finish.
All right.
So our fave five college football movies, and the most work I did on my list and the most thought I put into it was between the honorable mentions and the five, what was going to make it in and out.
Yeah.
So, number five, my college football movies for me, was The Waterboy with Adam Sandler.
We are calling a timeout.
Yeah, we're already going to do that. I figured yeah. as much.
We are going to ice the kicker, and we will revisit this later.
Okay. All right. So that's my five. We'll leave that for now. I'll throw your number five to you, and we'll see how far we can get.
All right. Mine is Rudy, number five.
All right.
We're not icing the kicker?
No, sir. You go ahead.
We're diving right into it. Okay, yep. Awesome. Yeah, this is I haven't seen this movie in a long, long time, but obviously you see some highlights and you know the oh yeah, by the way, we're gonna spoil everything. Just a heads up for those listening who have not seen these movies.
Good call. Spoiler alert.
We are going to spoil a lot, so you have been warned. yeah, so Rudy, he makes the tackle at the end. but it's this journey to this guy who undersized, slow, shouldn't be on the football field. He just wants, that's his lifelong dream, you know, play for Notre Dame. And prior to this movie, I really didn't know Notre Dame or about them or whatever, what they were.
Okay.
But you kind of see this idea of Notre Dame being separate and apart from college football, and even kind of to date, like still a lot of teams and fans resent Notre Dame for being separate and apart, or feeling, for lack of a better term, holier than thou.
Right.
And I think this movie either started it or fed into it. Because obviously you see like we're going to be independent and have special rules for us. And for a while there, they had just NBC would only play Notre Dame games.
Yeah.
But yeah, I get it now, because this movie was like, hey, this is college football, and this is the top of the top. And I was just fascinated by that. Like, oh wow, this is. This is the team that Jesus plays for. Okay,
right.
they must be better than everyone else if they have touchdown Jesus. But the movie was about this guy who's a nobody, shouldn't be on the field, but finally gets his one shining moment, and gets the tackle, and you're like, that's it. Yeah, just reading the synopsis, like that's it. But it's pretty cool how he just. Doesn't listen to anybody and is determined to just play. He just wants to play. Knows he's not going to be the star. Just wants to play for his team, and he finally gets the chance to do so.
Yeah, that's a good one. And I think that one got close to my list. But since I have another Notre Dame movie, I'm going to go ahead and talk about that now. But it's on my honorable mention list, and that's Newt Rockne, All-American.
Yeah,
this was one that was filmed. It was based on the coach, and I actually, after watching the movie, found out it's pronounced Canute Rockne.
Really?
Yeah, the K is not silent.
Huh.
But it tells about his life of being a kind of a chemistry standout student, of playing, of then coaching at Notre Dame, and I thought it was a decent journey. By the way, Ronald Reagan plays the part of the Gipper.
Okay.
But it's basically a semi-biographical, I guess is a better term, of the coach. And so it kind of takes the journey from his childhood overseas and then moving to South Bend and kind of making a home there. I didn't realize that before Canute Rockne showed up that Notre Dame was nothing. And this was the early 1900s, and they were just that little school in South Bend. Until they started being the likes of Army, and Canute was one of the first people to actually use the forward pass. Like,
okay.
It wasn't new, but no one used it. It was just a rushing attack from everybody. And so they used that, and they started beating teams pretty handily. I think he won two national championships. But like you said with Rudy, the reason it didn't make my list is, to me, it was just a little too heavy on the Notre Dame propaganda.
Right.
And
ooh, propaganda. I like that. That's a really good way to to say that. Okay, continue.
Yeah, because, I mean, you go through the early 1900s, they start winning national championships, but at the end of the movie, they make sure to remind you of how many more they'd won and the continued success they had. And so it was a little too much for me. You do get the famous line, you know, go out there and win one for the Gipper.
Right.
From this movie. So certainly iconic, and I understand why some people don't have on their list, but couldn't quite squeeze mine in there.
I've heard about this, but, you know, I've never actually seen the movie. I know all the references. I know what it's about, the general gist. I never actually saw it.
Okay. Okay. It's worth a watch.
Yeah. I might have to do that.
Excellent. All right. So that was your five. Make sure I got the numbers here. We're holding off on my five, and that was your five. So I'll go to my number four then.
Correct.
That's all right. Okay. I'm hesitating because I don't want to get too excited or committed to the movie because I might get iced again. So number four for me, college football movie, is The Blind Side.
Time out.
Okay.
We are going to ice kick her again.
Okay. All right. I figured as much. Think. I think we're going to cross over quite a bit here, which totally is fine with me.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so I'll kick it over to you for your number four then.
My four is We Are Marshall.
Okay, so I'm going to ice you this time.
Okay, good.
Time out. I have a feeling it's going to happen, so a lot for the fans. We appreciate your patience while we work through this, because we'll talk about all these movies.
We will get to them, yes. We will talk about them.
So you got it at four. Okay.
Yeah.
Let me try this again. I feel like this one will probably not be on your list, but let's see. Number three is The Express.
Not on my list.
Okay. All right. So here we go. So The Express was a great movie, and this was a movie about the first African-American to win the Heisman Trophy.
Right.
So it was a big focus on Syracuse. To me, this film showed the reality of anything you would imagine with college football in the 1950s, right. Whether it's relationship to the NFL, whether it's race relations, whether it's the father figure slash coach who has the player slash son. And it made you feel uncomfortable sometimes because it showed how the school wanted to recruit, and it was very tough because not everybody at that time was as forward a thing as they are now. And
right.
You struggle to constantly get this person in school, to get them comfortable. You have all the politics that goes in it and voting for this person and who would be against it. But it showed a really good reality. And so that to me was the reason why it was so high on my list, is because it didn't shy away from the facts, but it also didn't do it in a way that was a little overbearing. So I know you said you haven't seen it, but are you familiar with the synopsis and kind of how it works or the plot?
I mean, not really. Like, I know it's a, Syracuse, that's in number 44, like, I really don't know about this too much, honestly.
Okay. So the acting was really good in this one, which is also why it went up. So the movie is based on Ernie Davis.
I knew it was Ernie something. Yep. Ernie Davis, yeah.
Yeah. So what I liked about it was how they constantly – by the way, the actor that did it, I think his name is Rob Brown, did a fantastic job. Dennis Quaid, he's better than average to me. That's a personal opinion, but –
okay.
He did probably one of his better jobs in this film. And there was a constant shadow in the background, if you will. It wasn't just about race sometimes, but it was about getting other alum back to convince Ernie Davis to go to school. And so they used Jim Brown a lot. But
okay.
Jim Brown kind of flashed back to days at his playing days at Syracuse that weren't so great. And his relationship with his coach wasn't fantastic either. So I love that they showed that and how he was constantly asked to recruit Ernie Davis to go to Syracuse, even though he didn't even feel welcome there.
Right.
Didn't have a great relationship with the coaches. So those are some reasons why I put that at number three. It's worth a watch for sure.
Good, good. Yeah, it's definitely an important movie. And it's good when a movie makes you feel uncomfortable. Especially what was going on at the time. You're like, if you feel uncomfortable, imagine being him, you know?
Absolutely.
That's good. I really want to. I was when I was researching, I was like, man, I really want to see this movie, but I haven't. So, but I'll look into it for
Okay.
sure.
Excellent. All right, so that was my number three. I'm gonna toss it over to you for your number three now.
All right, my number three. It's a movie. I'll be surprised if you had seen this, but it is The Program.
Yes, sir. And that was actually my number two, so I want Aisha. You just share your thoughts on the program,
Oh,
and then I'll kind of tag mine on. But yeah, on my
okay.
list for sure.
Great, great. It is a classic 90s movie. I mean, just absolutely classic. And all the tropes you see with the stereotypical college football programs, with from the starting quarterback's abusive father, there's the big dumb jock who's taking steroids.
Right.
You have the love interest girl on campus whose jerk boyfriend is cheating on her. It's so like I forgot like a lot of the stereotypes come from this movie. Like movies you see later on after this. It's like, yeah, this one's it was so it's just so funny. It's so 90s from the clothes that they wear.
Right.
Just everything was just hilarious to me. Especially going back and watching it. It's kind of cringeworthy a little bit because you're like, oh, we wore that in the 90s. We did.
And it was so
We
cool.
yep, it was cool. And I mean they acted like it was cool and like, yep, we acted like it was cool too. Oh, it's But it was good. It's very, you know, very accurate to what it was like to live in the 90s.
Yep, I couldn't agree more. Great choice of James Caan as the head coach.
Right.
The steroid plot line was one that always stuck with me. And true to the name, they took from top to bottom of what a program looks like and portrayed it perfectly. And one other thing that stood out in that movie was, and I forget the full context, but the head coach is talking with a guy, and I believe the academic grades came up at one point, whether a guy would be eligible to play.
Right.
And his justification was, well, we don't actually seat 70,000 people in the stands to watch someone do a chemistry problem.
Yeah. Yep.
And whether or not people admit that, that's still the truth now, and that's how
Yeah.
they
Yeah.
feel.
Yeah. There's a lot of programs that are today that being accused of stuff going on back then. Some shady stuff for sure. And it's just interesting to see what people will do to win and. It's at the end of the day, it's about money, you know, putting the fans in the seats and who are going to pay you and what will you do to get that money.
Absolutely.
One of my favorite scene though is when they're recruiting the star player, I forget his name. But anyways, they're recruiting him and he gets on campus off the bus and they have like the band and cheerleaders, like, you know, welcome, welcome, you should come here, right? And so he chooses that school to go to, and his first day on campus, he gets off the bus and there's no one there. And he asks the quarterback, like, where's the band and where's the whatever? And he's like, they don't come here for like another 2 weeks. He was like, and he's like, yeah, well, we got you now, so it's no big deal. Like, it was just real funny. Like, we
Right.
tricked you. We know what we did. It was
Yeah.
pretty funny.
Yeah. So I really liked that one actually. Yeah. So that was my number two for all the reasons we just described. Excellent. So
Oh,
then I guess then I'll pass it back to you then for your number two.
well, my number two, and that is an ice kicker from earlier, and that is The Blind Side.
Okay.
Yeah, story of Michael Orr, and it's a really cool story. I knew about the story, you know, it being in the SEC, and I knew about him and his story, but really cool to see it on the big screen, and just this kid who has nobody and just is adopted by this family who has a lot of money and
Right.
she sees that he has potential. The mom sees he has potential or he's she looks past, you know, the outside and sees, oh, he's just a big teddy bear. Big Mike, you know, and sees that he can do something with his talents and just to see his journey, to you know, playing college, and then obviously we know he makes it to the NFL as well. It's really cool. Really cool touching story. And remind you that, like, it doesn't matter what people look like. Like, it really is, like, in the heart that really matters from both sides, her, the mom and Michael.
Absolutely. And it's heartbreaking to me to know that there are so many kids that come from those situations, football or not. And yes, it's such a good message to see past that and to do what they did. And I also liked this film added a touch of reality. Not only, of course, is it a biography, but you bring in actual SEC coaches into the film to try and recruit. And so you get a little bit of a taste on how that works as well. How the X's and O's work, how you have to survive with your grades to get the scholarships and all of the things. You had mentioned the parade and the buses that come with you, you know, all those things they promise and deliver when you're being recruited, and then how it's very different when you actually show up.
Yeah. Oh, man. I remember in the, I was watching in the theater, and the car crash scene, I knew, I could just tell something was going to happen. And man, when they get in that car crash, I just, my heart just dropped. I'm like, no, no. It's one of those, like, I know, like, I've seen enough movies. I can kind of tell where, when certain stuff's coming. And I knew something was going to happen, but still got me. Gets me every time I get in the car wreck. Every time.
Yep. And that, again, knows that we can tell the movie was good from that because it makes you feel uncomfortable and you feel the gut wrench.
Yeah, it got a reaction out of me.
Yep.
Which is good. Yeah.
Absolutely. So great one. I think most people would agree that's on the top of their list as well. And because again, the acting, Sandra Bullock did a fantastic job.
Yeah, and then they have like a country music star as the dad.
Yes, Tim McGraw.
Yeah, I think so.
Sound right?
Yeah, he did a good job. I was surprised.
Yes, 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 indeed. I hesitate to say Tim McGraw because I can maybe list five country singers and I couldn't even pair him with the songs they sing.
Really?
So it's kind of a joke in my family that they just kind of quiz me on country music and I couldn't tell you anything. I do know that Toby Keith is a Sooner fan and he shows up on the sidelines for them. That's all. That's it. And it's because it's college football. I don't know this music.
I can name pretty much any. Oh, I can sing along with any country song in the 90s.
Oh.
Prior to that and after that, I have no clue. And that's because my mom, she was big into country, and we didn't have a say on what we listened to. I don't think she listens to it as much now, but we listen to so much country music, and I don't like country music at all, but I can sing along with any song. I'll probably name some of the
okay.
Well, some
at least
of it,
you can limp it through
to,
it.
Yeah, yeah. It has to be 90s. Anything after, it all sounds the same.
Okay.
Whatever. But I don't know. I know, like, Alan Jackson, George Strait, Brooks and Dunn, Reba. I mean, I'm not proud that I know all of them, but I do know all of them.
Yeah. Now, you grew up in, like, the central North Florida area. And
yeah.
I it's different for me. I grew up in Texas, so for me to not know country, people are just like, "What?" I'm like,
"Oh."
I think there was a Thunder Rolls song in the early '90s by maybe a Garth Brooks or Brooks and Dunn. That could
Garth
be the same
Brooks.
Person for all I know. But that's
Garth
it.
Brooks and Dunn. That's who it is.
Okay.
Garth. Oh no! That was Garth Brooks, Thunder Rolls and Lightning Strikes.
And Lightning
oh
Strikes.
My goodness! I don't know why I know that. There's some information that there's some like important dates that I should know and people I should know, but they're not in my brain because there's some country music songs.
Instead,
that are just
you have the trivia from that.
Taking it up, just taking up space.
Well,
and music. I can remember watching music videos. Oh yeah, it's ridiculous. So yeah. Anyways, let's move on to something more
from the country. Yes, that was
yeah. So.
Uh,
so yeah, it was good to see. As a really really cool movie, I really enjoy it. And obviously, it taking place in Ole Miss and just all the SEC coaches popping in really made me smile. And
sure,
yeah, it was real cool. I like that movie a lot.
Great choice. Now, make sure I'm getting this right. That was your number two, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So I'm going to go to my number one then.
Okay.
And for me, the number one movie is We Are Marshall. So this is
Okay.
one that we did the ice kicker for earlier. We Are Marshall is not, in reality, the funnest movie. It's
No.
not like we're going to have a party, and then we're going to watch We Are Marshall and be uplifted and have a great time and laugh about it. Because it deals with such a tragic event.
Right.
It's was very sad. It tells a story. I think it was in the early 70s of a plane crash that killed a lot of the Marshall football team and coaches. And this was something to me. Matthew McConaughey was the perfect choice as coach.
Right.
You also have, I'm blanking on the guy's name. He was on Party of Five. He's also on Lost.
I know the
The
guys.
assistant coach. It'll come to me
I
in a
don't
second.
know.
Another great choice. And you see just the heartbreak and how they work through it.
Yeah,
They,
Matthew Fox.
thank you so very much, Matthew
Thank you,
Fox.
IMDb.
So yeah, it's something that actually ended up being historical as far as college football goes. Up to this point, freshmen were not allowed to play. And the school, because they had lost so many players and they had a hard time filling their roster, they got permission from the NCAA to play freshmen. And I think this was before you even redshirted. But they allowed Marshall to do it first when no other school could. They basically kind of pitched that as you're going to have playing time if you come to Marshall. And so that historic ruling has since gone on, and we've got 5 and 6 year eligibility now. It kind of went a little to the extreme, but that was where it kind of started. And then, of course, the other thing that Florida State fans could and should know about this movie is that Bobby Bowden is a character. At the time,
Yes.
he was a coach at West Virginia, which, of course, is very close to Marshall.
Yeah.
And they were often recruiting the same players. And so Bobby kind of implemented a, in remembrance of Marshall. So there's a pretty decent reference to that as well.
Right. Yeah, it was one of those movies I did not know about this incident prior to this movie.
Oh, wow.
And which is insane. That's a huge deal, like a plane crash and killing so many players from a school, and a school like I know the school. So yeah, I was surprised. I'm like, how did I miss this? But yeah, it starts off just on a sour note, and like, where do you go from here? Like, and I'm just trying to fathom, like, what do you do? Like, what, how do you even begin to pick up the pieces? Should you even pick up the pieces, and continue? And yeah, it was really good. And McConaughey did a great job of taking on that burden of starting over. And but yeah, I didn't know about the freshman stuff either, too. That's really cool. Really, really cool. Interesting movie.
So it was, to me, for all the reasons, from the freshman being able to play, for overcoming tragedy, for how real it was. Those were all the
Right.
reasons why I had him up in my number one. And that's an interesting question that you posed, which is, how do you pick up the pieces, but should you even try?
Right.
And that was something that they addressed in the movie as well, is, should
Right.
we even be playing football after that? So the movie does end on a happy note because you flash to see all the success Marshall went on to have, from Byron Leftwich to Chad Pennington, excuse me.
Pennington, yeah.
And of course, their standout best player of all time, Randy Moss.
Yep.
So you kind of flash forward and see all the success they had and how they eventually moved up to Division One, which is where they are now.
Right. Yeah, it was really cool. And it's one of those, like, I think of this when I think of when I know it's different circumstances, I understand completely, but when Penn State, after their whole scandal with Sandusky and Paterno, and they're having to start over. And just, it was interesting watching that. I can't imagine what it would be like when, after SMU got the death penalty. Obviously, different levels of severity with each one, but you're interesting. It's just cool to see. I don't know if cool is the right word, but interesting to see how you even begin to start to rebuild.
Right.
When it's not like you have a player get hurt from an ACL injury. We're talking like hundreds of lives are affected.
Yes.
And a city, a town is affected, you know. So it was an interesting piece, and I'm glad I got to see it and learn more about that program.
Yeah, it was very educational on that front. And just a further thought on recovering from, like, one person being injured or something like that. Unfortunately, we still see small tragedies happen at campuses. It could be a player committed suicide.
Right.
It happened at Washington State in the offseason. Or you had a kicker from USC a few years ago just died in an accident. Just fell off of a cliff, I believe.
Right.
I forget the circumstances there. Or you have, I think UConn a few years ago, you had one of their players who was killed in a shooting.
Yeah.
And you see all that, and it is sad, but it is also encouraging to see those teams recover. But those were isolated incidents, you know.
Right.
You had dozens of people that passed all at one night.
Right.
Marshall. And so we haven't seen any kind of scenario when anyone's had to rebuild from there, and that's probably a good thing.
Yeah.
But you still get pieces of that, but to see it happen all in one instance like that was something unique.
Right. Right. Cool. So that was your number one.
Yes, sir.
So we're going to – my number one is going to switch gears a little bit and bring some levity, hopefully,
to
our list. And that is an ice kicker from earlier, and that is the Water Boy.
Excellent.
Adam Sandler at the prime of his Adam Sandler.
Yeah.
Before he – I don't know what he's doing now with his movies. Before Jack and Jill and Click and – all those, yeah.
Ugh. I think it's safe to say, in my opinion, he's a much better director than he is an actor anymore.
Yeah, and he was putting out some quality stuff early on.
Absolutely.
But I don't know if I'm not sure what's going on. I just don't like the stuff he's putting out now as an actor. But you're right, I think he's pretty good at directing. Anyways, he was phenomenal as Bobby Boucher in this movie. Phenomenal. I can quote this movie forwards and backwards. Mr. Coach Klein, Mr. Coach Klein. Medulla Oblongata. Never heard of that prior to that movie, but now I know what it is.
Right.
You know, thanks to that movie. It's just this ridiculous concept of this water boy who has a lot going on in his life. But he channels his rage, and his coach realizes that he has a rage. But if you channel it and you point it in the right direction, people could get hurt, you know. And he's used it for his football team, and I think it's just hilarious. It's one of my favorite sports movies, and definitely my favorite college football movie with the I believe it was the South Central Louisiana State Mud Dogs.
I remembered Louisiana only, but you got the full name. Well done.
Yeah, I will. And do you remember the bowl game they went to?
I do remember that. It was the Bourbon Bowl, right?
Yep. Remember when Bobby Boucher showed up at halftime and the Mud Dogs won the Bourbon Bowl?
That so unique of a movie. And
right.
How they ever got Henry Winkler and Kathy Bates to play in this film, I will not know. But kudos to the casting director on that.
Just legends.
Yeah.
To being this ridiculous film. it was so funny. The water sucks. It really, really sucks.
Such a unique take on it. And you're right. In a time when college football and you see movies like The Program come out, you see this on the other side of it.
Right.
Which shows a lighter side of the sport, which kind of had that Cinderella feel to it as well. So you kind of want to root for them. Yeah, it was fantastic. And there's a lot about this movie that's entered modern culture now. And like the Medulla Oblongata. There's just too many. I could go on.
Oh, I got more. You can do it.
Yeah. We suck again when he's in the hospital and they can't play. Yeah.
And you just think, like, As ridiculous as that guy is, I know people like that.
Oh, do
They're
you?
like, oh, one thing happens. Oh, we're the worst. Here we go. It was a funny, and actually, a little bit of trivia. James Bates, who was a linebacker for Florida in the 96 season, middle linebacker.
Yeah.
He was one of the football players in that. And he also was like a sheriff or something like that as an extra in that movie.
Wow.
So
I know that.
that it just kind of the cherry on top for me as a Gator fan. But that movie is just I can't stop smiling when I think about it.
Fantastic. Yeah, that was a good one. That was my number five. That one actually was one I kind of toyed with. I was like, it's too good to be in the honorable mention category, so it has to get ranked. So,
Right.
excellent. Excellent. Great choices. Now I'm going to want to rewatch some of these after we've talked about them now.
I have to get on the express, man. I have to get on that.
I highly recommend it. And I think all of the ones on your list I had seen.
Okay.
So, again, the challenge out there to any up and coming directors, please make some more college football movies for us,
Please,
because
yes.
the documentaries are fantastic, and I have a good feeling we'll talk about that later. But these movies are great. So, excellent list.
What do you got any honorable mentions
I do
that we didn't talk
now.
about?
This one probably is borderline college football, which is why I didn't make the list. But I really like the movie Drumline with Nick Cannon.
Oh, wow.
So that's more of a focus on the band experience and halftime, being. But I mean, there's recruiting in that one. It's kind of his story as a freshman going to, I think the college was Atlanta A&T, remember correctly. But it was great. The only movie to really focus on drumline or to focus on marching bands. So the whole aspect of that. So college football is really kind of a footnote, and you never really see any football action in this movie. But I feel like that was just a really good tale of a freshman going through training camp, going through practices, seeing what it looks like to actually perform. It was a fantastic film.
Awesome. I had two. One I was gonna do just for fun, but I couldn't do it. Forrest Gump. But
Yes.
that's not about college football, although it has a good scene.
Right.
Him in Alabama. But actually, a couple years ago when Alabama played Notre Dame in the national championship game, I saw a sign that said Rudy versus Forrest Gump.
Oh my, that's good. Oh
Yeah,
man.
it was pretty funny. Pretty funny. But I wasn't really seriously considering that. But the other one though, I just missed the list. There's a movie called Necessary Roughness.
Okay, now that's one I've heard of and haven't seen. So tell me what that one's
Okay.
about.
It is about a school I haven't seen in a long time, but it was kind of like the Waterboy before Waterboy, just kind of poking fun at college football, starring Sinbad, the comedian.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was in it, and I'm not sure what the premise was, why they. I don't know if it was sanctions or whatever, but like the starting football players could not play, weren't allowed to play, so they found a loophole where they go, well, if we just got regular students to play, can we still put on a team?
Wow.
So they just got like random people from the school to play, and like Sinbad was like a lineman, and they had like a female kicker, and just kind of like random silliness ensued. It was kind of like the program meets Police Academy.
Oh my.
If you can, that's the best way.
So it's a comedy then.
It's a comedy. Yeah, absolutely, it's a
Okay.
comedy. I don't remember the name of the. It's a fictional school, but I remember their mascot was like the armadillos. Took place someplace in Texas,
Excellent.
but I don't remember. I remember seeing it as a little kid a couple times and thinking it was hilarious, but I don't remember too much after that.
Okay.
That's why it didn't make the list.
Okay.
But yeah, it's still pretty funny. At least it might not be funny now. I don't remember. I remember when I was little, I loved it.
Yep.
I don't know if it's still funny.
Some of those translate to adulthood. I find that for me, most of them didn't. And but I'll be sure to check that one out for sure, because I think I had heard of it, but never, first of all, never knew Sinbad was in it, so that's a seller for me.
Oh, a big Sinbad fan, aren't we?
Yes. House Guest is probably one of my favorite movies from the
Okay.
90s, actually.
Okay. Then you'll love Necessary Roughness then.
Okay. Excellent. Yeah, that was my only honorable mention was Drumline, and so I thought about throwing Rudy on there because I like the story, but and we've talked about this a little bit. I just can't like Notre Dame, and that weighs too heavily, and I know it's something I should get over, and I tried, but I just can't.
You're not alone.
Yeah.
You're not alone.
So that's a great list. That's a whole lot of fun to talk
Yeah.
about. So I appreciate your insight and at least the recommendation there. And I don't know, what did we have? Three that were crossed over? We are Marshall, the program, and the blind side.
And Waterboy.
Waterboy. So 4 out of 5
Yeah.
we're the same. So excellent,
Yeah.
excellent, excellent.
Cool.
Great talk. Well, I know that there are a lot of people out there that want to share their list, or maybe they classify another movie as a college football movie when we maybe didn't or didn't put on the list. But would you mind telling the fans, Chris, how they can get a hold of us whenever they want to share their top five list, or they want to remind us of how we missed something?
Absolutely. The best way to reach us, well, if you want to just see all of our content, is our website at floridafocuspodcast.libsyn.com, LibSyn. You can also hit us up at Facebook and YouTube at Florida Focus Podcast. Please tweet at us on Twitter at Florida Focus Pod, and we would love to hear some feedback through email at floridafocuspodcast@yahoo.com.
Excellent. So yeah, we encourage you guys to reach out to us. We appreciate the listen. Any last thoughts before we sign off tonight, Chris?
Yeah, if you do email us, just email us some quotes from the Waterboy that I did not hit, just so I can see him and smile and go, "Oh yeah, that was in there."
I'm glad we opened that up, because sometimes when we do that, you're like, "Oh, I didn't even think that was funny," but then you rewatch it, you're like, "Oh, perfect. How did I
Right,
not?"
yeah. Or yeah, you forget a quote till someone says you're like, "That is right. That was hilarious." So please hit us up with some more quotes from the Waterboy.
Fantastic. See, you're making me want to put that higher on my list, and kind of wish I had now.
It's good. You gotta watch it again.
I have a tendency to move toward the dramatic, so that's kind of why my list was a little bit more mirror.
I could see that. I could see
Yeah.
that.
Excellent. Well, thanks for everybody who's out there listening. However you are, we appreciate you reaching out to us. Thank you so much for listening to Florida Focus, the College Football Podcast. You guys take care.
See you later.